Welcome to the first part of a three-part series on severe weather education. My name is Jim Westland, and I'm a meteorologist with the National Weather Service office in Birmingham. In section one, I will take an overview look at the science of tornado and severe thunderstorm forecasting and detection. The first thing we need to do is define what a tornado actually is. A tornado is a violently rotating column of air descending from a thunderstorm and in contact with the ground. They can take on all different kinds of shapes and sizes, but all will have these three attributes in common. They can be relatively thin and rope-like, or they can be large and wedge-shaped. Some are even partially invisible, with only some dust or other debris being kicked up on the ground as evidence that the tornado does indeed go all the way down to the ground. Many other cloud formations and even optical illusions can produce phenomena that appear to be tornadoes but aren't. These include shelf clouds associated with thunderstorm outflows, dust devils, and what are known as cold air funnels. Obviously, not all thunderstorms produce tornadoes. In fact, it's estimated that only about 1 out of every 100 thunderstorms in the United States produces a tornado. In central Alabama, there are three main categories of thunderstorms that produce tornadoes: supercell thunderstorms, tropical rainband thunderstorms, and all other non-supercell thunderstorms, often in the form of long lines or large bow-shaped line segments. The most common type of tornado-producing thunderstorm is the supercell. A supercell is a special, well-organized type of thunderstorm that can persist for several hours. Supercells form when there is a perfect combination of instability and wind shear. Instability is a measure of buoyancy in the atmosphere. An unstable air mass will cause a warm bubble of air near the ground to rise up, much like how the hot air in a hot air balloon lifts the balloon up into the air. Wind shear is simply winds blowing at different speed or direction at different heights. When there is little instability, thunderstorms sometimes have a hard time growing in the first place, and if they do form, they usually start out relatively weak, but they can grow stronger and organize into a line if the wind shear is high and other conditions are conducive for thunderstorm growth. And that is what happened here. These thunderstorms formed in an environment of high shear, but relatively low instability. The cold front that was helping to set them off was strong, and it caused the weak storms to grow and to form into several different line segments. Each of the lines was then capable of producing damaging straight-line winds. The yellow box west of Montgomery is where the National Weather Service issued a severe thunderstorm warning, just for that possibility. These storms would go on to produce damaging straight-line winds in Lowndes County, and indeed all the way eastward to the Georgia state line. Thunderstorms can also form when there is little to no wind shear, as long as there is enough instability. And this happens a lot during the summertime. Thunderstorms in these conditions are usually disorganized and relatively short-lived, but they can become quite strong and even severe. These thunderstorms developed on a hot July afternoon. Each storm cell you see on this radar image moved very little, essentially popping up and growing in place and then dissipating within a span of 30 to 60 minutes. Once again, even though the storms lack any organization, that doesn't mean they aren't capable of producing severe weather. The yellow box in Montgomery County shows the severe thunderstorm warning that was issued for that particular storm that produced damaging straight-line winds in several locations just east of the city of Montgomery. When the instability and wind shear are both strong enough and in perfect balance, then thunderstorms become so organized that they last for several hours and begin to rotate. These are the supercell thunderstorms, which produce a majority of the tornadoes in central Alabama. The supercell in the middle of this image moved from west to east across a large portion of central Alabama, maintaining its strength and rotation for several hours. We'll see this particular storm in a bit more detail in section 2. A supercell is still no guarantee of a tornado. In fact, the latest research shows that only about 1 in 5 supercells goes on to produce a tornado. Weather research projects, such as Project Vortex, are continually trying to find answers as to why some supercells produce tornadoes while others do not. What you need to remember is this. If you hear the term supercells in a weather broadcast for your area on a particular day, then that is a day you need to be especially weather aware. The most violent tornadoes, and the ones that stay on the ground the longest, are those that are associated with supercell thunderstorms. Tornadoes are rated on the enhanced Fujita rating scale, which assigns a number from 0 to 5 based on the amount of damage a tornado produces. An EF0 tornado produces light damage, while an EF5 tornado produces incredible widespread damage. Fortunately, most tornadoes tend to be the weaker ones, EF0 and EF1, while the violent EF4 and EF5 tornadoes are rather rare. In fact, since modern tornado records started being kept back in the 1950s, 70% of the tornadoes in Alabama have either been EF0 or EF1, while the most violent EF4 and EF5 tornadoes accounted for less than 3% of all Alabama tornadoes. Over the past 4 years, from 2008 through 2011, 61% of the tornadoes in central Alabama came from supercell thunderstorms. The remaining 39% came from thunderstorm types other than supercells, such as squall lines and tropical storm rain bands. And that's an important thing to remember. Other thunderstorm types besides supercells can produce tornadoes. If that perfect balance between instability and wind shear is just off in some way, then instead of organizing into supercells, thunderstorms can organize into long lines, often called squall lines. Under the right conditions, parts of these lines of storms can also start to rotate, just like a supercell thunderstorm would. And any thunderstorm that rotates fast enough is capable of producing a tornado, whether it's part of a line of many thunderstorms or a single supercell. National Weather Service meteorologists have gotten pretty good at identifying days when the combination of instability and wind shear is just right that may lead to organized, rotating thunderstorms and squall lines. Depending on how favorable conditions are or are not expected to become, the Storm Prediction Center will either designate each day as having no risk of severe thunderstorms or tornadoes, or designate certain areas of the country as having a slight, moderate, or high risk of severe thunderstorms. Again, if you hear that your area is under a slight, moderate, or high risk of severe thunderstorms, then that is a day to be especially weather aware. A tornado watch is issued when conditions are favorable for the formation of severe thunderstorms that may produce tornadoes within the next several hours. In central Alabama, an average of 8 to 13 tornado watches are issued each year. Tornado warnings are issued when a tornado is sighted by storm spotters or when certain features and patterns on radar suggest that a tornado is or soon will be forming. And do keep this in mind. Due to certain geographic limitations, National Weather Service Doppler radars only detect storm rotation. The rotation associated with a tornado within a storm is typically too small to see with our current radar system, the WSR-88D. That concludes Section 1. In Section 2, we'll take a closer look at the warning process, and in Section 3, we'll look at some things that you can do to better protect yourself from the hazards associated with severe thunderstorms.